second Soul Cup semi-final. Reynad will lead with the Paladin, just like he did yesterday. Tiny Finn and all.
Time for some Tiny Fins.
This is Mattson on the Warlock, and no Tiny Fins, but I spy a Wisp.
Oh yeah, and Selfless Hero too, a card that we saw come in towards the end of the game yesterday. Definitely a card we're going to see in a lot of aggro paladin lists, already seeing in a lot of aggro paladin lists in Standard. There he is, there's a Hobgoblin. Okay, knew he was in there somewhere.
It was ironic that when we were talking about expectations for the Wild format, I really hoped and prayed for a Hobgoblin, and we're going to see a Hobgoblin deck from Reynad. He's innovating once again, but let's see how he goes against the Warlock.
Baby Finn. Tiny Finn, I'm sorry.
Betraying yourself there. You were hoping and pleading for the life.
No, in Korean it's called Baby Murloc, so that's why I always like mix up the name.
You were hoping and praying for the Tiny Finn to stay alive yesterday. It managed to, as Reynad piloted this deck to a win.
Reynad not playing it because he wants to save it for the Hobgoblin. Gets another one. That's going to be a big turn three for this guy.
Hellfire already looking like something very necessary, but Doom?
Yeah.
Doomsayer is in the hand. Do you play the proactive Doomsayer? There's no board. There are definitely a lot of boards. You know, if we see 3-1 damage creatures come out, Doomsayer, of course, very likely to live.
I think you do. I think you play the Doomsayer.
But you can understand it being used reactively in a deck like Reynad's that can potentially be.
And that person worked on Reynad equals aggro.
Yeah.
So Mattson just debating. He doesn't really have another play this turn. Tap is the only thing that really looks palatable.
Oh, this is such a huge power play from Mattson.
Yeah, I think it's a really good idea. I mean, Mattson's smart, man. He knows what kind of deck this is. He knows that turn three is a really big, really scary swing turn. So I think it's smart to play that now.
Both the combos, the Steward of Darkshire and the Hobgoblin, come online on turn three with cards like the Wisp and the Meltdown. Look at this, another big draw. The Hellfire certainly will be a big, relevant card. And seems like Mattson has all the tools to deal with what will be, at some point early in this game, a big board from Reynad.
Wow. Do you Keeper of Ulduma the 3-4 already?
I don't think so.
Because you usually want to use a Keeper of Ulduma to a Death Throne minion, whatever comes out, whether it be Mal'Ganis or Lord Zerustus.
It seems like he's trying to use one of his expensive cards both to have a favorable trade, but more crucially, to get that Divine Favor turn online. If he can play his Hobgoblin turn and also Divine Favor, he really has a chance to refill after something like a Hellfire.
Well, I mean, he has set himself up to play everything in his hand except for Divine Favor next turn, so I suppose there is that. But it doesn't give him a lot of board presence, per se, right now. Gets a Dark Bomb out of his opponent's hand. What's going to come out? Looks like Drax is going to hit the board. That's not good for Reynad either.
Definitely a minion that he can't answer short of a quality.
A little bit of saltiness coming.
Goblins and Gnomes time.
It's time for the Tiny Fins.
Time to go off for the Hobgoblin deck.
Oh, how perfect. Three Tiny Fins.
They will all die.
They will all die in agony.
Hellfire, but oh, man. It's so nice to see them for just the 5 seconds.
Ironically, if it was a Golden Hellfire, you would see Murlocs burning in the animation. We won't see
what?
It here.
Really?
Yes. Yeah, yeah, in Hellfire.
That's
yeah.
They're Murlocs, if you look closely.
Oh, I never noticed that.
It goes back and references the early World of Warcraft days. One of the, I think the cinematic for Burning Crusade had a Warlock torching a bunch of Murlocs with Hellfire.
So we will see the Divine Favor turn come out with the Wisp draw, so it will be a 5-card hand refill.
Second, very nice.
Second
Hobgoblin.
And ooh, the Selfless Hero flies into the hand and onto the board.
That's good. And he can play that Selfless Hero because, again, that doesn't work with Hobgoblin, so might as well get that out there right away. Need the one attack minions for Hobgoblin.
By the way, Mattson has Alexstrasza in his deck. I just realized that.
Yeah.
Since he knows that this is a Reno Jackson, let's not expecting a second Hellfire, but we've noted already that multiple board clears available to Mattson. He has Shadow Flame in hand as well, and Lord Drax is sticking around to be a Shadow Flame target if necessary.
I mean, I just don't know how Reynad is ever going to kill Mattson because he's got Alexstrasza and he's got Reno Jackson in his hand already. And even if Reynad gets him low.
Yeah, he can play everything at his hand.
He could.
It is.
Well, he doesn't have enough room in the board, though, does he?
It is the Sylvanas as well, so.
That too.
How does he want to interact with this board?
Probably want to kill the Sylvanas first. Maybe run into it with a shielded mini bot and the Haunted Creeper just so you have a better chance of giving away something. Although, you have a chance of giving away the Divine Shield minion then, that's not good.
Yeah, the Selfless Hero wouldn't be.
Yeah, don't want to give him that.
A great donation to the side of Mattson, especially with some of his high power creatures that will come out soon. He's going to lead with the Hobgoblin, though.
All right, may just be thinking about going to face this turn then.
Yeah, the longer this game goes on, the more guaranteed that Reno Jackson is in the hand. We know there's Alexstrasza as well. Let's see, really wants the Divine Shield on the Hobgoblin. Doesn't get it.
Oh!
Actually goes on to one of the Divine Shield minions already.
Ouch. Wow. So that's interesting, because you have cards that prioritize freezing targets that are not already frozen, but you don't have targets that give Divine Shields to cards that don't have it yet. You don't have that priority for a Selfless Hero. Huh.
So this seems like a good turn for Shadow Flame. After you kill the first body of the Hunter Creeper and take off the Divine Shield from the Shield of Minibot.
Also guarantees it'll be the 3-3 that he takes away. Can play Bran Bronzebeard as well, and Rain had called it a 10% deck. That was enough percentage to take out Kranish, but now with the extra information available, he's basically on life support, and this may already be the concede. There it is.
Yeah, no surprise there, really. I mean, there wasn't much Raynaud could do from that point to win the game, and this is the deck that he said, you know, well, I'm going to have like a 10% chance to win a game. And you could still win with this deck. I mean, it's not a good matchup to go against Reno with that super face aggro Hobgoblin Paladin deck, but it could still beat something else that Mattson has.
Yeah, and also Mattson had two of his removals, two of his AoE cards at the first hand cards of his deck, yeah. Whereas Kranish only had one Consecration and never drew into it yesterday.
And you follow your logic though, Doa, and my issue is that Mattson has brought Freeze Mage and Murloc Paladin. Now, Murloc Paladin, maybe there's an argument very early burst down, but because it's such a board-centric deck. Freeze Mage has all the freeze effects. Blizzard basically clears a whole board.
Well,
is there really a list that Mattson has brought that this particular Paladin deck can beat?
I said he can beat it, not that he probably will. I don't think he will, but it's possible, you know? We saw one yesterday.
It's certainly going to be an underdog moving forward. Reynaud moves away from the Paladin list after not finding a win, so we will see Paladin from Mattson, confirming it is a Murloc Paladin against what is Grim Patron Warrior, but certainly some adaptations from Reynaud, most notably the Leroy Jenkins, but also the Ragnaros.
Yeah, and he did use two Corcoran Elites in the deck, so it really gives him a lot of time to... What am I talking about?
A lot of reach.
A lot of reach in terms of direct face damage, so Reynaud can definitely finish Mattson off before he even uses his first Anything Can Happen.
I actually like this list from Reynaud. I like how super aggro it is, because it is a situation where you can come up with so much surprising burst from hand in a deck that people don't really expect a lot from, you know, since the Warsong Commander nerf. So
if you think about it, four charge minions and Ragnaros is just a crazy burst from a deck that became so board-centric after the changes to Warsong Commander.
Yep.
Not even a hero power. Doesn't want to give a target for Armorsmith or Acolyte Pain.
So we'll see the Acolyte of Pain onto the board, and Doomsayer and, in future turns, the True Silver Champion are great answers to that Acolyte.
This Doomsayer is going to be pretty juicy, right?
I think it's really good right now, yeah.
Yeah, denying any draw from the first Acolyte of Pain.
You know, you could make an argument, I guess, for the Murloc Warleader since it trades, you know, straight up with it, but I think just preventing the entire next turn from Reynaud more or less is pretty good. I mean, there's always a possibility on Mattson's side that you don't know if there's an execute coming out of the Warrior, but it's worth the risk.
And I consider cycling the Acolyte of Pain. Execute would give him an answer to the Doomsayer.
Well,
one damage short of being able to clear it.
Might as well just play that weapon.
He's even going to hit a swing?
He's thinking about it.
I like this because... okay, all right. I think in that situation you probably should swing, because if you draw the Deathbite next turn, you're probably going to want to play that, and then you don't get anything out of the Fiery War Axe.
That looks like a Grommash Hellscream.
Whoa. Grommash has really hit rock bottom there, hasn't he?
That bit of stubble. He's really, you know, let himself go. Solemn Vigil online because of the Doomsayer at 3 mana. So able to play that. And it's also worth knowing that there's no ambiguity about Reynaud's list. Mattson knows there's a lot of reach. He knows it's an aggressive patron list, so getting that early damage in and threatening, whether it's the Leroy or the Grommash or the Ragnaros, early lethal is basically the playtime for Reynaud, because the moment that things like Lay on Hands and all the other healing from Mattson deck comes through, it's going to be difficult for Reynaud to finish off the Murloc Paladin.
Yeah. Well, Nice play by Motson. Just gets the True Silver Champion out, handles the Frothing Berserker. Things are going well.
Isn't it better to play the Acolyte Pain over the Frothing Berserker?
Well, of course. You don't want to lose the Frothing Berserker again just like that. I mean,
it does kind of suck that you're only getting one draw off of it.
Yeah. Not Hero Parting again. He wants to set himself up for as much of a Battle Rage as he can a little bit later.
Yeah, he doesn't even have Battle Rage at hand just yet.
Not yet. So he knows it's coming.
How do you approach this turn? Because you could use your Weapon Charge, but remember, could just use the Murloc War Leader and Bluegill to trade with the Acolyte. Still denies the
draw. I really like that play because the Bluegill Warrior is still going to survive with 1 HP after making the trade.
Would also finally develop a board.
Yeah, be something.
He could also play double Acolyte.
I guess, but I like this. I like being able to put some pressure onto your opponent that way. Might even decide to save the Weapon Charge. Yeah. Aha, Korokrani Elite, number one. There's the Grim Patron, so starting to maybe sort of move towards that combo. But Raynaud's had some really kind of unfortunate draws this game. He's gotten a lot of his expensive stuff early on. Look at that. I mean, Dr. Boom, Grommash, Ragnaros.
Yeah, and that on the screen just said, what is it? Everyone get in here. The Patreon lines.
The infamous call that kind of changed after the Warsong change.
Well, everyone still gets in here now. They just don't pile on.
Yeah, they don't do direct damage either. Wow, he's going to go for it.
Okay.
So there's only so many answers in this deck. There's quite a few, and it seems like he just wants to leverage the minimum amount of tools to potentially draw out specifically in a quality, because that would be really massive for Raynaud in terms of future turns.
Well, he's got so many more threats than these Grim Patrons in this deck that he can do this and set up for a better Dr. Boom turn next turn.
Yeah, Motson can hold on to his equality this way too.
Yeah.
So we'll see how Motson approaches this turn. He was thinking about playing Acolyte, which would mean he wouldn't be investing into the equality.
You could go Acolyte and Consecrate after you kill the 3-3 with your True Silver Champion, and that would clear the board, leave your Acolyte of Pain out there. I guess it'd still get destroyed by the weapon, but hey, you've got two, so.
Equality is just so much more valuable. He's gonna. Now, he has Equality Consecrate in hand, that's why he can afford to take what looks like a very suspicious line from Raynaud.
Well, the other thing, too, is that now he's saying to Raynaud, like, all right, you know, you have to use your dudes to kill my Acolytes of Pain before you use any Whirlwind effects, I suppose, but it is a little bit awkward.
Yeah, but Raynaud is playing really smart, and he's not committing to the board at all.
Well, literally, this is a turn that hasn't been made for many, many a tournament. You know exactly how the patron interactions work at this point, so it's heavily suggesting, at minimum, equality in the hand for Motson.
Should be Equality Consecrate this turn. Oh, it could be Equality along with the Wild Pyromancer too, I suppose.
I don't know if I actually agree with what Motson has just did. He could have just get away with using one Consecration and keep the Equality for the Pyromancer Equality combo later on in the game.
That's what I was expecting. I thought he was going to hit the 3-3 with his weapon and then just Consecrate.
Me too.
And the reason why that's more flexible is that Equality is relevant at all stages, whereas Consecrate is that more situational card against the Patron Warrior. So I agree with you guys. He does find a second Equality and Pyromancer,
is really lucky.
It is
and
lucky.
You never, you almost never get good Consecration value against Warrior, even against Patron Warrior. So I don't understand why he was holding onto that card so much.
Well, this definitely rewards what seemed like overly greedy play from Motson. Sometimes the heart of the cards does reward that greed. It's going to be the Dr. Boom this turn.
All right. Hovered over the Ragnaros for a second, but I think Dr. Boom is going to get a little bit more mileage in terms of removal that you would rather have used on that than Ragnaros.
You just look at the hand though. Ragnaros, Grom. Doesn't have a Grom activator yet, but the finishing damage is there. And will we see Motson run low on these removal tools? He does have basically only removal in hand, Humility even, alongside the Humility effect of the Outdoor Peacekeeper. So for now, he seems very robust in halting the aggression from Raynaud.
Yeah. Murloc Paladin is a really
one damage.
Interesting deck.
A little bit of salt coming up from Raynaud.
You know, I didn't know. I actually didn't know that Raynaud was a fellow Minnesotan with me.
Oh,
until
is he really?
This weekend. I had no idea. Yeah.
He's your kin, Della.
He's my Minnesota brother. So I feel the salt too now when I see these situations.
Well, I mean, the issue here is that literally Mattson has every answer possible. Humility, Equality Consecrate, Wild Pyromancer Equality, even the Lay on Hands. The Sludge Belcher was the last draw, which also halts Raynad. One of the three roll onto the Outdoor Peacekeeper, doesn't get it. Now with 9 mana, trying to work out how to approach this turn.
Yeah.
Could be, let's say, it depends how much he wants to extend, because you could understand to some degree the Frothing Berserker and charging into the 1-2, but...
I mean,
able to fit in Hero Power there as well.
You're still going to lose that Frothing Berserker so quick, so you'd rather have a little bit more gain out of that. I think maybe you could run the Corcoran in and then Battle Rage.
It's going to be Corcoran and...
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, so the Battle Rage online gets rid of the Taunt. As you mentioned, will be very easy to deal with the Frothing Berserker, but it is something that will look to provoke the weapon, second part of the weapon.
The problem is that Mattson has already sacrificed a lot of Murlocs, I suppose, and he's getting to the point where Raynaud's lost a little bit of health, and Nemifin is starting to get to be a bit of a concern, I think. If Mattson draws it, of course.
Well, Lay on Hands will certainly help. Ragnaros the Light Lord, one of those extra healing cards he has, and there is the first Anyfin.
Are we going to have a Ragnaros off? I hope we do.
That would be awesome.
Oh yeah, that'd be so cool.
Fire Lord versus Light Lord. I really love the new Ragnaros. I think that's great that they're kind of playing around
it's
with the Lord.
It's
like
definitely a Ragnaros
that.
Turn right now.
That's right. 8 damage, insect.
So I guess we're not going to see a Ragnaros fight off anymore.
We're going to see an Equality Consecrate. That's what we're going to see. Potentially a Wild Pyromancer Equality.
Yeah, I mean, you might as well save the... Well, yeah, Consecrate's probably better to use here, because then you can save the Pyromancer. Whoa.
Can I actually clear with the first Anyfin? The next one...
Interesting.
Will most likely represent lethal. Hasn't played Old Murkai yet, but now does have the 4 charge Bluegills and soon to be 2 of the Murloc War Leaders. That means there'll be 6 damage on each of those Bluegills, so the next one represents at minimum 24 damage.
It's true. It's a good point. Yeah, Raynaud knows. He thinks it's time to gain some armor. And he's got those 2 Ravaging Ghouls to do that with, right? He can play 1 Armorsmith here. He can gain, 6 armor.
Again, the minimum total is 24 after removing. Anything more will mean that anything won't be 1 turn lethal.
You can actually gain a lot of armor here. Oh, he's not playing the second Armorsmith.
I hate playing Unstable Ghoul against Paladin. Please don't do that.
Makes it quality, not even require much of other activators. I follow your logic there. Looks like he doesn't want to kill off the Murloc. That makes sense.
Well, he's trying to set up a kill with Grommash next turn. That's the plan here.
Second Anyfin is not lethal.
There it is.
Unless my math's totally off.
Well, he would still get 1 more War Leader and he'd get 4 Bluegills. So it'd be that 24 damage. So yeah, I don't think it would be.
Old Murkai certainly seems to be towards the bottom of the deck. A lot of drawings already happened for Mattson, but hasn't found the Old Murkai. Still has a quality Consecrate, but this board is certainly not very threatening. It's a 15 life total, so getting closer and closer to it being a worrying life total. Could play the Ragnaros, trade with the Ravaging Ghoul, and guarantee that the heal goes face.
True. That would be good.
Now, what damage reach is there? You respect 14 from hand, so it would be safe with the Ragnaros heal. But if he does trade like this, he will not be playing Ragnaros this turn. Wouldn't be able to guarantee that the heal goes to face.
Silver Champion, and...
Can Raynaud get lethal if he draws into Execute?
I wonder. We should be seeing the Sludge Belcher here, shouldn't we?
Yeah, even after the Sludge Belcher.
There we go. Okay.
So Execute
okay,
comes
mind.
Through. It would not be lethal. Getting closer and closer, though, but we know there are other healing options available to Mattson. Actually, only Ragnaros in hand right now.
I mean, you'd have to imagine there's Forbidden Healing in this deck, too. I don't know if we saw it yesterday, but you'd think it'd be in there.
I like this. He's going phase with the Grommash Hellscream.
Yep.
He does have, what, 2 more charge minions in his deck?
Leroy Jenkins.
1 Corcoran Elite and Leroy Jenkins.
Yeah, very true.
So still plenty of reach. Again, is staying above 24 life total, which right now represents the maximum damage from anything.
I mean, you're kind of committed at this point, right? He's wondering about using that whirlwind to get three more armor here. Before, you know, and then attacking with the armor smith. So you'd get four total.
I'll step back. Worth noting that there's still that second weapon charge, so it's actually 28 damage if you include the weapon. Well, it's four blue gills.
Is it four?
Yes. Okay. Four blue gills, two Melech war leaders, and the weapon.
I think this is okay. A little bit better overall. Better to save that whirlwind.
I had a lot of APAC winter casting Melech versus Melech, so I started picking up some of the trends.
Those games were insane, man. Holy cow.
And here it is, the Brethren of the Fire Lord.
It's like I'm back and I'm feeling much better about life right now.
Ultra optimism of the Light Lord. We'll
that
push him up
music, as well. Though. That's yeah. So cool.
The live insect is also amazing.
He does say live insect when he heals too, I believe.
And he does return die insect when he attacks, so yep. It's great. So Leroy here would only be 7 damage with this one attack. Grommash Hellscream.
He doesn't have any way to deal with the Light Lord right
here. He does
here.
Have 35 health, so that's...
Yeah, I suppose. But you're running out of removal here if you're the Paper
Warrior. Yeah, and their Ragnar's is stealing 8 heal every turn.
And 8 damage to you.
So
oh, yeah, that's
37,
true.
No weapon. We're talking about 32 damage. So he will not die to anything.
All right, 8 health. And does he get the Forbidden Healing?
Second Murloc Wall Eater. Which will be the third, given the that one will be the two will be rezzed by the second anything. Needs that War Leader to die, then he would have guaranteed lethal, I believe. It would be 8 damage times 4, which is 32, which for now isn't lethal, but it's getting closer and closer.
Can Ragnar's the Light Lord heal himself or not?
Yes, he can.
He does? Okay.
It heals
that's
a random,
really scary.
Heals a random character.
I thought he couldn't heal himself, but now that he can actually do that to himself.
Yeah, certainly not a clear turn now.
Yeah.
Really wants to hold on to that anything. Must be very close to the bottom of this deck, but crucially has not drawn old Murkai yet.
Yeah, I think if Matson clears here and plays Stable Duel.
Has to play a taunt.
Yeah.
He's going to play the Doomsayer as well, it looks like.
Whoa.
Wow. Wow.
Thinking about
really?
It heavily.
So he's thinking of suiciding his own Light Lord?
I don't think I'd do that.
He's heavily debating it. Rope is going to burn. Looks like he thinks better of it.
He
Ragnaros kills the face.
Did he not attack? Oh, no, he did attack earlier. He killed the 3-3. Never mind.
So there's some more charge. Leroy, the only charge minion left in the deck of Reyna, the only finisher. I believe there is an inner rage as well to maybe increase the reach.
Did Reyna use any of his executes yet?
I don't think so.
One inner rage, no execute, I believe.
Okay. No execute in the deck?
No execute used.
Oh, no execute used, okay.
Would have to heavily expect two executes.
So with the unstable goal, the Light Lord is less likely to kill Metzen's face anymore. Oh, he can actually kill the Light Lord, okay.
Yep, and then do a little bit of damage to face with the Korkran Elite.
36 is still, 38 now is still just clear of anything, and we will have an issue where there could be a certain role, and whether old Murkai came out of the anything could be very relevant.
Whoa.
Let's do the maths here. 38 is what's required. 8, 16, 24, 32.
32.
So I was correct. That feels good. Sometimes Murloc math is hard, but no cards in hand is going to be very difficult to clear, so...
Yeah, that's the problem, is that he needs to draw like a brawl, and that is not in this deck, I'm pretty sure.
No one card will deal 11 damage.
That's not going to be enough.
One taunt will not be enough. There's the concede, and Matson, good problem solving. Realized his situation. No cards in the hand of Reign Admit. No real chance for that board to be removed. And Matson is one game away from the grand final. 2-0 up against Reign Admit.
Man, I gotta say, this Murloc Paladin deck is terrifying and wild. You've got so much healing, so much removal.
And we've never actually seen one of these Murloc Paladins play the Forbidden Healing, which is extra healing on the top of Ragnaros. All the other effects.
Yeah, we saw some yesterday, but it is just, I mean, when you have, and I like Ragnaros Light Lord in this deck too.
Yeah, me too. It's especially good against Freeze Mage, it seemed like.
Going straight into the potential final game. 3 match points for Matson. This is going to be a good matchup for him though, but it isn't Control Warrior. It is going to be Patron Warrior against what you can clearly see is Reno Freeze Mage.
Reno Freeze Mage. Yeah, that's interesting.
So when we have seen these Reno Freeze Mages in Hearthstone Masters, they have included duplicates. So
yep.
Reno will be a lot more situational. That's something that came to punish Kranish yesterday, who had a Reno Secret Paladin but never drew in to Mysterious Challenger to cut down on those duplicates.
Right. And the idea here is similar, where in a Reno Secret Paladin, you're counting on drawing Mysterious Challenger to pull those secrets out and activate Reno. And in this deck, you're kind of looking at using Mad Scientist to pull some of those secrets out of your deck, and then you've just got a couple duplicates for board clear, and you're kind of planning on just having such a long game that you'll save that Reno till the very end. Cold Light Oracle, wow. I had that in my Freeze Mage deck back in 2013.
It's a card that when you have less ability to run duplicates, still run some, but you have to draw the lines somewhere. The guaranteed two-card draw of the Cold Light Oracle becomes something situationally that you can consider.
Yeah. I mean, again, when you're running duplicates in a Reno deck, too, you do want to include a lot of draws so you can cycle very quickly through your cards and get rid of those duplicates. Raynaud's got a pretty good start here as far as the draws he's going to be able to get out of his Acolyte of Pain, probably. Although the Torch might come in handy. Matson might just decide to take out the Acolyte that way. Seems pretty good.
Upgrades his reach in the late game as well when the Roaring Torch comes through. So, clean kill on Acolyte and slowing down the drawing for Raynaud is looking very attractive. The other option would have been Ice Barrier, which would allow at least two draws for the Acolyte.
All right. So that's the turn for Matson. Does he attack into this? Okay, he will.
Was this necessary?
I don't think so.
Let's put it in ping territory, but I follow you guys' logic. Seems kind of neither here nor there in terms of decision making.
Yeah, it's plenty of draw. I don't think he really needed to do that.
Maybe he was worried about Frothing Berserker and Whirlwind, but that is one Whirlwind down. I don't know if he should have been afraid about that.
Now you have this 4-mana turn where it's going to be certainly on the uninteresting side. We'll play the Novice Engineer to continue the cycle.
Raynaud's feeling more confident at the moment.
Smork.
You could.
Something going better than expected. Yeah, it does have access to the second Corcoran Elite.
I think there's no much point in playing the Ravaging Goal because that is going to put your own Corcoran Elite into the hero power range for the mage.
Does have a turn 6 patron combo with Inner Rage and Whirlwind.
You do want to hero power as many times as possible, so that's probably what he's thinking about.
I mean, I think you could make an argument for Ravaging Ghoul and Armorsmith. Game 3 armor, and yeah, you do put yourself within hero power range, but if they hero power, then that means they have a 3-mana turn. So you do kind of slow down the mage there, too.
I was considering playing Grim Patron, but without the ability to use Whirlwind, seems...
Yeah, you can wait just one more turn and do the Grim Patron, Inner Rage, and Whirlwind.
I mean, if you do that, though, then you're running right into the Blizzard turn, which is... awkward, you know.
But Matsu can still coin out the Blizzard next turn.
Yeah, I suppose that's true.
And he has Flamestrike in this list. Most of the Torch Freeze Mage standard lists we've seen have been cutting that Flamestrike, but it is available.
Smork
was what the first call was, and Smork is what we see.
I mean, if you think about when we saw things like Murloc Paladin beating Freeze Mage yesterday, it's because they were able to get this chip damage in early. So it's kind of the same philosophy with the Patron Warrior right now.
And Raynaud has some crazy damage burst. 8, for example, with Inner Rage Leeroy, which would have been online on this turn. Doesn't have Leeroy in hand, but the potential's certainly there in terms of finishes. And if he can start drawing some premium removal for what is just 2 Corcoran Elites who have already dealt damage, he'll feel pretty good about his position. Reminder to anyone coming in late, Matson up 2-0. Single elimination, second semifinal, so... the winner of this series goes on to play Strife Crow in the grand final right after this.
So you could coin out a Blizzard here, which is going to kill everything on the board. But if you do that and Raynaud uses his Green Patron, Inner Rage, and Warming combo, then you're at a huge risk. So he saw that coming.
Yeah, I like this turn from Matson. He's playing it slow. He's not getting too worried by these charge minions. He's still got Reno in the hand, and he's not going to be able to use it right away, but...
yeah, and that Acolyte Pain kind of has a taunt by itself, because you want to kill it one shot.
Yeah.
Then we have this interesting scenario where Coin is still available, has Flamestrike, so...
ugh.
Although it is a surprising Grim Patron turn with no weapon put together, there is still an answer for patrons in that Flamestrike.
And he's been saving that coin for so long. If you're Reynaud, you gotta start to be wondering if he's got that Flamestrike in there.
Because this is a Reno list, I think we saw that there is Archmage Antonidas, so coin does have potential other use, but...
That's true, too.
Does have a lot of answers still. And
I think this is still the only play for Reynaud. I think you still have to go for the Grim Patron turn.
He's really unsure of himself.
It's one of those situations where you're afraid of the removal, but they either have it or they don't, and you really... There's no way to predict it, so just go for it.
What does he do with the Cochrane Elite? Because he hasn't traded yet. We have to keep tabs on that.
He's either going to go face and not Whirlwind, or he's just going to trade and then...
Is he going to Whirlwind?
No, okay.
Holds onto the Whirlwind, so does respect coin into removal. Really interesting heads-up play by Reynaud.
Yeah.
Shows restraint in a situation where you could have argued going off when it comes to a patron turn, but...
Yeah, people always make joke about how Reynaud is not a serious player, but when he makes these small little... thoughtful plays, it really shows up.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a long-time card game player, of course, in multiple different games. Some of the most famous plays in the infancy of the esports scene were Reynaud making creative plays. I remember a famous Hunter play with Savannah Hymane, I think
it was. Oh, I remember that, with the 5-mana...
It was
Rhino? Rhino?
With the Stampeding Kodo, I believe. No, not Stampeding Kodo, the Tundra Rhino.
The Tundra Rhino, yeah.
That went around the scene a couple of years ago, so... One of his rare appearances at a tournament, he's doing Reynaud has the Ragnaros for the turn 8, but for now he's just loading up the board and finally developing some of that armor. It's worth noting that because he's been proactive and charging the face, it isn't the 45-50 effective health total. There's no big armor to speak about for Reynaud.
Sludge Belcher from the Freeze Mage.
Hey, you need 30 cards.
I guess. I guess if it's Reno, you can put one in there. Interesting list, though. We can see he does have duplicates of things like Arcane Intellect, too, which kind of surprises me, given that he's got Loot Hoarders, Novice Engineers, and Cold Light Oracles. Do you really need two Arcane Intellect there?
It just feels like the Reno Jackson is sort of an ultra fatigue situation rather than any degree of reliability. Extra draw gets you closer to those duplicates, but so many situational cards does make this list come across as very clunky.
Well, Ragnaros is one of the most difficult cards for the Freeze Mage to deal with. The 8-8 body and the constant damage.
What do you do this turn? Do you just trade everything in to give only an ooze and the face as targets? Do you just Ragnaros pass the turn?
Guess so.
I think it has to be Ragnaros. The rest of its cards are super situational.
I mean, Ragnaros is pretty safe if you play it here. You've got that unstable ghoul. I suppose it could still die to, Fireball Ping.
Fireball Ping, because of the
ghoul.
Well, Ragnaros hitting face will be big.
Oh, 50-50 insect.
So there's no, as far as I know, there is no secret developed right now. I don't believe that Ice Block has been played, but our Observer overlay makes it hard to tell for sure.
Oh, Blood Mage.
Yeah.
Fireball and Ping is going to kill the Ragnaros.
That's right.
There is an answer. Reynaud sees that it's the rightmost card as well. As always seems to be the way in his story.
Reynaud's kind of stalled out a little bit, but this Fiery War Axe is actually a nice draw. He's going to be able to get some damage in now.
That reach, Grom Hellscream would certainly be very close to pushing lethal in future turns.
I don't know, man. I don't know. Metzen is holding on to the Ice Barrier.
Doesn't have Ice Block developed. Ice Barrier is going to be very crucial, as you mentioned. There's the Ice Block, finally.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
He can stall out the game as long as he wants from this point.
If we start seeing some of these duplicates being played, then, especially the Arcane Intellect, then we might be getting closer and closer to the Reno Jackson becoming online and pushing Matson away from a health total that Reynaud can hope to charge down.
Actually, because Matson just uses Blood Mage Thalnos, if Reynaud can draw into his second green patron, he does still have a pretty good chance of winning the game because there is no really clean way to deal with the board unless he has some kind of freeze AoE and Doomsayer combo.
And he has so many activators between the unstable ghoul, the ravaging ghoul, and Whirlwind that you're right, it would be a massive thing, but for now, no sight of the Grim Patron. Acolyte's a pretty welcome draw, though.
Yeah, well, and he can get an immediate draw with the unstable goal.
We'll see what he draws into.
Looks like he's going to take that draw. As a weapon, so could have cleared in a different way. Wants to hold on to the Ravaging Ghoul and the Whirlwind for the Patron turn, but what do you hold on to? What do you trade with? That's kind of the conundrum open with Reynad.
This is secretly really rough for Reynad, because as he attacks into this, it's going to give his opponent Ice Block, and that means that Manson has one out and has the other one in his hand.
That's a really good card.
Battle Rage. Looking for some reach, looking for some burst. Doesn't find any. Remember, he's at full health, so it was only a two-card Battle Rage.
Yeah, he really needed to find his Green Patron ASAP.
Yeah, he's quickly running out of options here.
And then when action comes back to Mattson, we may actually see Reno Jackson being playable.
We'll see.
Maybe one more duplicate card to consider for it to be alive, but we have seen a Fireball, we have seen one copy of each of the secrets come into play.
Two Frostbolts, I think, are still probably out there.
Yep, so yep. Still the two offs to consider.
So he only needs one Frostbolt for the Reno Jackson activation?
As far as we remember, yes.
Yeah, once it's in your hand, as long as in your deck there's only one each, I think you're okay.
Okay. Well, yeah.
It's not this turn, so after the Arcane Intellect, Reno Jackson would have been... So Reno Jackson, yeah, would have been a big play, but...
Yeah, it's just really nice that Reno Jackson actually has that yellow activation mark, because before we just had to guess and see if we had used every duplicate card in the deck.
Yeah, that made it kind of tough sometimes, for sure.
Well, still, hope and a prayer for Grim Patron. Next two turns, or bust, really, for Reynad. So we're getting closer and closer to the combo turns. Alexstrasza now in the hand for Mattson.
Yeah, you'd think that's probably what's going to come out next turn.
No executes used from memory, and still none in the hand for Reynad.
Well, no Doomsayer for Mattson just yet, either. So, as long as Reynad can draw... Green Patron. He is still at a fine spot.
What's he going to do about the 8-8 body of Alexstrasza?
Yeah, he's just desperately looking
draw
for
into
execute.
execute?
But how do you draw into execute and Green Patron at the same time, which is kind of where Reynad's starting to get to.
Battle Rage?
I think you really want an Alexstrasza here if you're Mattson. You've got the secrets out. You've got another Ice Block in your hand.
You don't have direct damage for a single turn burst, but Frostbolt is that duplicate card that we haven't seen, and that would be 11 damage with the double Ice Lance in hand.
I mean, Alexstrasza just straight up does 15 damage to Reyna. That's the, you know, effect here right now, and even though he does have some armor and he might gain more.
What else do you do this turn is kind of
exactly.
The question.
Yeah.
So, seems like Alexstrasza, both in the context of the game and the context of his hand, is smart.
Wow, even
okay.
Ice Lance.
Really doesn't want to have Alexstrasza get executed. Reynad obviously could have gone face if he had the execute in hand and then finished off Alexstrasza.
So Reynad has no answer to the Alexstrasza. Still has not found the execute. It isn't lethal in hand just yet, but 19 is the reach. I believe 20 actually with hero power is possible. It's going to focus on armor gain.
So you think Mattson could almost just ignore this, or he could just Frost Nova. Frost Nova, Emperor Thorsten, just go to face with Alexstrasza.
Do you draw with the Cold Light Oracle, or do you use ET here? I think you have to kill the Armorsmith.
Armorsmith does represent consistent healing, so he will trade, potentially buying Reynad another turn, but with Ice Block already developed, second Ice Block in hand, discounts coming on cards. Seems like Mattson is on the road towards his grand final.
I think so. Certainly looking that way.
Has a second Ice Lance, so could kill this time, but instead he'll just freeze the face.
I don't know about this. Losing out a lot of damage by using those Ice Lances that way, but he's
yeah,
also
but you're also giving
it.
That constant damage from your minions.
Ideally.
Yeah.
Reynad looks bemused. He has no play, has to pass the turn compared to 13 power on the board.
Oh, he got the activation mark on Reno Jackson, so Doomsayer was the first card.
Second Doomsayer. So we're going to see the Cold Light Oracle. A lot
Roaring
of burst
torch.
Here.
It's a lot of damage,
yeah.
Actually. That's getting very close to lethal for.
And remember, has Ice Block up, Doa, so two turn lethal is almost certainly guaranteed. Reno Jackson just to Push himself up to 30 finally.
Yeah, why not
board.
Freeze the board because you
yep.
can.
GG.
Really, nothing else to say. And Reynard looks bemused, but there's his Grim Patron just on time.
Yeah, so the question is, what can you do with Boombots and Whirlwind effects? That's
not so much.
Nah, you can't really do it and survive. You can, I mean, it's gonna be obviously Matsun's got two turns. This one's over.
Reynard deciding if he wants any style points.
Yeah, Reynard already used both of his Armorsmith. There's just no way for him to come back at this point.
Again, only kudos can be found at this point. No way to answer the board. So much direct damage. In fact, 16 with just the Pyroblast and the Roaring Torch, so.
Right. I mean, you gotta go for this. From Reynard's perspective, you have to do this.
Yeah, he's gonna try to get lucky.
It's gonna be a huge Frothing Berserker.
As the Whirlwinds also. That would just put the Frothing Berserker into ping range.
Aww.
Really?
Oh.
Okay. Oh. That kills Alexstrasza.
I mean, you gotta go for it, but we know he's dead. Matson's got the damage in hand. That Pyroblast and the Roaring Torch is gonna do it, and we're gonna have our first 3-0 of the tournament.
We've had 3-1s, both for Strifecrow. This is gonna be the 3-0. Just the Pyroblast, no mana's required, and Matson sweeps Reynard to book a date with Strifecrow in the grand final.
What a hot date it is, Papa Smithy.
The hottest of dates on Wild Format, though, the first grand final in Sangam East Stadium will be America versus Japan as Strifecrow takes on Matsun to find out who will be the winner of the Hearthstone World Invitational Soul Cup.
Should be a good match. I mean, Matsun really came into this with some interesting deck decisions. We always do see stuff that's a little bit out of the norm, or what we know is the norm, from the Japanese players. And Matsun plays it well.
Yeah, the Forbidden Healing from the Marlin Paladin and the Cold Light Oracle from the Paladin. Not the Paladin, but from the Mage.
Yep. Both of the players with something to prove, guys. We'll come back from the short break with the grand final. As we said, Strifecrow versus Matsun. Both solid players, both been playing very well. Let's see who will be the champion of this invitational event. Second Soul Cup semi-final. Reynard will lead with the Paladin, just like he did yesterday. Tiny Fin and all.
Time for some Tiny Fins.
This is Matsun on the Warlock, and no Tiny Fins, but I spy a Wisp.
Oh yeah, and Selfless Hero too, a card that we saw come in towards the end of the game yesterday. Definitely a card we're going to see in a lot of aggro Paladin lists, already seeing in a lot of aggro Paladin lists in Standard. There he is, there's a Hobgoblin. Okay, knew he was in there somewhere.
Ironic that when we were talking about expectations for the Wild format, I really hoped and prayed for a Hobgoblin, and we're going to see a Hobgoblin deck from Reynard. He's innovating once again, but let's see how he goes against the Warlock.
Baby Finn. Tiny Finn, I'm sorry.
Betraying yourself there. You were hoping and pleading
for
the
life. No, in Korean it's called Baby Murloc, so that's why I always mix up the name.
You were hoping and praying for the Tiny Finn to stay alive yesterday. It managed to, as Reynard piloted this deck to a win.
Reynard not playing it because he wants to save it for the Hobgoblin. Gets another one. That's going to be a big turn three for this guy.
Hellfire already looking like something very necessary, but Doom.
Yeah.
Doomsayer is in the hand. Do you play the proactive Doomsayer? There's no board. There are definitely a lot of boards. You know, if we see 3-1 damage creatures come out, Doomsayer, of course, very likely to live.
I think you do. I think you play the Doomsayer.
But you can understand it being used reactively in a deck like Reynard's that can potentially be.
And that person with our Reynard equals aggro.
Yeah.
So Matsun just debating. He doesn't really have another play this turn. Tap is the only thing that really looks palatable.
Oh, this is such a huge power play from Matsun.
Yeah, I think it's a really good idea. I mean, Matsun's smart, man. He knows what kind of deck this is. He knows that turn three is a really big, really scary swing turn. So I think it's smart to play that now.
Both the combos, the Steward of Darkshire and the Hobgoblin, come online on turn three with cards like the Wisp and the Meltdown. Look at this, another big draw. The Hellfire certainly will be a big, relevant card. And seems like Matsun has all the tools to deal with what will be, at some point early in this game, a big board from Reynard.
Wow. Do you Keeper of Ultima the 3-4 already?
I don't think so.
Because you usually want to use a Keeper of Ultima to the Death Throne minion, whatever comes out, whether it be Mal'Ganis or Lord Zoroastus.
Seems like he's trying to use one of his expensive cards both to have a favorable trade, but more crucially, to get that Divine Favor turn online. If he can play his Hobgoblin turn and also Divine Favor, he really has a chance to refill after something like a Hellfire.
Well, I mean, he has set himself up to play everything in his hand except for Divine Favor next turn, so I suppose there is that. But doesn't give him a lot of board presence, per se, right now. Gets a Dark Bomb out of his opponent's hand. What's going to come out? Looks like Drax is going to hit the board, and that's not good for Reynard either.
Definitely a minion that he can't answer short of a quality.
A little bit of saltiness coming.
Goblins and Gnomes time.
It's time for the Tiny Thins.
Time to go off for the Hobgoblin deck.
Oh, how perfect. Three Tiny Thins.
They will all
die.
They will all die in Hellfire, but
oh,
it's
man.
So nice to see them for just 5 seconds.
Ironically, if it was a golden Hellfire, you would see Murlocs burning in the animation. You won't see
what?
It here.
Really?
Yes. Yeah, in Hellfire.
That's they're Murlocs, if you look closely.
Oh. I never noticed that.
It goes back and references the early World of Warcraft days. I think the cinematic for Burning Crusade had a warlock torching a bunch of Murlocs with Hellfire.
So we will see the Divine Favor turn come out with the Wisp draw. So it will be a five card hand refill.
Second
Hobgoblin.
And Selfless Hero flies into the hand and onto the board.
That's good. And he can play that Selfless Hero because, again, that doesn't work with Hobgoblin. So might as well get that out there right away. Need the one attack minions for Hobgoblin.
By the way, Mutsun has Alexstrasza in his deck. I just realized that.
Yeah.
Since he knows that this is a Reno Jackson list, not expecting a second Hellfire, but we've noted already that multiple board clears available to Mutsun. He has Shadow Flame in hand as well, and Lord Drax is sticking around to be a Shadow Flame target if necessary.
I mean, I just don't know how Reynard is ever going to kill Mutsun because he's got Alexstrasza and he's got Reno Jackson in his hand already. And even if Reynard gets him low.
He can play everything at his hand.
He could.
It is.
Well, he doesn't have enough room in the board, though, does he?
It is the Sylvanas as well, so.
That too.
How does he want to interact with this board?
Probably want to kill the Sylvanas first. Maybe run into it with a shielded mini-bot and the Haunted Creeper just so you have a better chance of giving away something. Although, you have a chance of giving away the Divine Shield minion, then that's not good.
Yeah, the Selfless Hero wouldn't be.
Yeah, don't want to give him that.
A great donation to the side of Mutsun, especially with some of his high power creatures that will come out soon. He's going to lead with the Hobgoblin, though.
All right. May just be thinking about going to face this turn, then.
Yeah, the longer this game goes on, the more guaranteed that Reno Jackson is in the hand. We know there's Alexstrasza as well. Let's see. Really wants the Divine Shield on the Hobgoblin. Doesn't get it.
Oh!
Actually goes on to one of the Divine Shield minions already.
Ouch. Wow. So that's interesting, because you have cards that prioritize freezing targets that are not already frozen, but you don't have targets that give Divine Shields to cards that don't have it yet. You don't have that priority for a Selfless Hero. Huh.
So this seems like a good turn for Shadow Flame. After you kill the first body of the Haunted Creeper and take off the Divine Shield from the Shielded Minibot.
Also guarantees it'll be the 3-3. Takes away. Can play Bran Bronzebeard as well, and Reynard called it a 10% deck. That was enough percentage to take out Kranish, but now with the extra information available, he's basically on life support, and this may already be the concede. There it is.
Yeah, no surprise there, really. I mean, there wasn't much Reynard could do from that point to win the game, and this is the deck that he said, you know, well, I'm going to have like a 10% chance to win a game, and you could still win with this deck. I mean, it's not a good matchup to go against Reno with that super face aggro Hobgoblin Paladin deck, but it could still beat something else that Mutsun has.
Yeah, and also Mutsun had two of his removals
against the Patron Warrior, so I agree with you guys. He does find a second Equality and Pyromancer,
is really lucky.
It is
and
lucky.
You almost never get good Consecration value against Warrior, even against Patron Warrior, so I don't understand why he was holding onto that card so much.
This definitely rewards what seemed like overly greedy play from Mutsun. Sometimes the heart of the cards does reward that greed. It's going to be the Dr. Boom this turn.
All right. hovered over the Ragnaros for a second, but I think Dr. Boom is going to get a little bit more mileage in terms of removal that you would rather have used on that than Ragnaros.
You just look at the hand, though. Ragnaros, Grom. Doesn't have a Grom activator yet, but the finishing damage is there. And will we see Madsen run low on these removal tools? He does have basically only removal in hand, Humility even, alongside the Humility effect of the Outdoor Peacekeeper. So for now, he seems very robust in halting the aggression from Reyna.
Yeah. Warlock Paladin is a really
one damage.
Interesting deck.
A little bit of salt coming off from Reyna.
You know, I didn't know. I actually didn't know that Reyna was a fellow Minnesotan with me.
Oh,
until
is he
this
really?
Weekend. I had no idea. Yeah.
He's your kin, Della.
He's my Minnesota brother. So I feel the salt too now when I see these situations.
Well, I mean, the issue here is that literally Madsen has every answer possible. Humility, Equality Consecrate, Wild Pyromancer Equality, even the Lay on Hands. The Sludge Belcher was the last draw, which also halts Reynard. One of the three roll onto the Outdoor Peacekeeper, doesn't get it. Now with 9 mana, trying to work out how to approach this turn.
Yeah.
Could be, let's say, it depends how much he wants to extend, because you could understand to some degree the Frothing Berserker and charging into the 1-2, but
I mean,
be able to fit in Hero Power there as well.
You're still going to lose that Frothing Berserker so quick, so you'd rather have a little bit more gain out of that. I think maybe you could run the Corcoran in and then Battle Rage.
It's going to be Corcoran and...
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, so the Battle Rage online gets rid of the Taunt. As you mentioned, will be very easy to deal with the Frothing Berserker, but it is something that will look to provoke the weapon, second part of the weapon.
The problem is that Madsen has already sacrificed a lot of Murlocs, I suppose, and he's getting to the point where Reynard's lost a little bit of health, and Nemifin is starting to get to be a bit of a concern, I think. If Madsen draws it, of course.
Well, Lay on Hands will certainly help. Ragnaros the Light Lord, one of those extra healing cards he has, and there is the first Anyfin.
Are we going to have a Ragnaros off? I hope we do.
That would be awesome.
Oh yeah, that'd be so cool.
Fire Lord versus Light Lord.
What?
I really love the new Ragnaros. I think that's great that they're kind of playing around with the lore like
that. It's definitely a Ragnaros turn right now.
That's right. 8 damage, insect.
So I guess we're not going to see a Ragnaros fight off anymore.
We're going to see an Equality Consecrate. That's what we're going to see. Potentially a Wild Pyromancer Equality.
Yeah, I mean, you might as well save the... Well, yeah, Consecrate's probably better to use here, because then you can save the Pyromancer. Whoa.
Can I actually clear with the first Anyfin? The next one
interesting.
Will most likely represent lethal. Hasn't played Old Murkai yet, but now does have the 4 charge Bluegills and soon to be 2 of the Murloc War Leaders. That means there'll be 6 damage on each of those Bluegills, so the next one represents at minimum 24 damage.
It's true. It's a good point. Yeah, Reynard knows. He thinks it's time to gain some armor. And he's got those 2 Ravaging Ghouls to do that with, right? He can play 1 Armorsmith here. Can gain, what would it be, 6 armor?
Again, the minimum total is 24 after removing. Anything more will mean that anything won't be 1 turn lethal.
He can actually gain a lot of armor here. Oh, he's not playing the second Armorsmith.
I hate playing Unstable Ghoul against Paladin. Please don't do that.
Makes it quality, not even require much of other activators. I follow your logic there. Looks like he doesn't want to kill off the Murloc. That makes sense.
Well, he's trying to set up a kill with Grommash next turn. That's the plan here.
Second Anyfin is not lethal.
There it is.
Unless my math's totally off.
Well, he would still get 1 more War Leader, and he'd get 4 Bluegills.
24.
So it'd be that 24 damage. So yeah, I don't think it would be.
Old Murkai certainly seems to be towards the bottom of the deck. A lot of drawings already happened for Madsen, but hasn't found the Old Murkai. Still has a quality Consecrate, but this board is certainly not very threatening. It's a 15 life total, so getting closer and closer to it being a worrying life total. Could play the Ragnaros, trade with the Ravaging Ghoul, and guarantee that the heal goes face.
True. That would be good.
Now, what damage reach is that? You respect 14 from hand, so would be safe with the Ragnaros heal. But if he does trade like this, he will not be playing Ragnaros this turn. Wouldn't be able to guarantee that the heal goes to face.
Two Silver Champion, and...
Can Reyna get lethal if he draws into Execute?
I wonder. We should be seeing the Sludge Belcher here, shouldn't we?
Yeah, even after the Sludge Belcher.
There we go. Okay.
So Execute
okay,
comes
mind.
Through. It would not be lethal. Getting closer and closer, though, but we know there are other healing options available to Matten. Actually, only Ragnaros in hand right now.
I mean, you'd have to imagine there's Forbidden Healing in this deck, too. I don't know if we saw it yesterday, but you'd think it'd be in there.
I like this. He's going face with the Grommash Hellscream.
Yep.
He does have, what, two more charge minions in his deck?
Leroy
One
Jenkins.
Corkling Elite and Leroy Jenkins.
Yeah, very true.
So still plenty of reach. Again, is staying above 24 life total, which right now represents the maximum damage from anything.
I mean, you're kind of committed at this point, right? He's wondering about using that Whirlwind to get three more armor here. Before, you know, and then attacking with the armor smith. So he'd get four total.
I'll step back. Worth noting that there's still that second weapon charge, so it's actually 28 damage if you include the weapon. Well, it's four blue gills.
I mean, is it four?
Yes.
Okay.
Four blue gills, two Melech War Leaders, and the weapon.
I think this is okay. A little bit better overall. Better to save that Whirlwind.
I had a lot of APAC Winter casting Murloc versus Murloc, so I started picking up some of the trends.
Those games were insane, man. Holy cow.
And here it is, the Brethren of the Fire Lord.
It's like I'm back and I'm feeling much better about life right now.
Ultra Optimism.
Two of his AoE cards at the like first-hand cards of his deck,
yeah.
Whereas Kronosh only had one Consecration and never drew into it yesterday.
And you follow your logic, though, Doa, and my issue is that Matten has brought Freeze Mage and Murloc Paladin. Now, Murloc Paladin, maybe there's an argument very early burst down, but because it's such a board-centric deck, Freeze Mage has all the freeze effects, Blizzard basically clears a whole board.
Well,
is there really a list that Matten has brought that this particular Paladin deck can beat?
I said he can beat it, not that he probably will. I don't think he will, but it's possible, you know? We saw one yesterday.
It's certainly going to be an underdog moving forward. Reynad moves away from the Paladin list after not finding a win, so we will see Paladin from Matten, confirming it is a Murloc Paladin against what is Grim Patron Warrior, but certainly some adaptations from Reynad, most notably the Leroy Jenkins, but also the Ragnaros.
Yeah, and he did use two Corkon Elites in the deck, so it really gives him a lot of time to, what am I talking about?
A lot of reach.
a lot of reach in terms of direct face damage, so Reynad can definitely finish Matten off before he even uses his first Anything Can Happen.
I actually like this list from Reynad. I like how super aggro it is, because
mm-hmm.
It is a situation where you can come up with so much surprising burst from hand in a deck that people don't really expect a lot from, you know, since the Warsong Commander nerf, so.
If you think about it, four like charge it. Minions and Ragnaros is just a crazy burst from a deck that became so board-centric after the changes to Warsong Commander.
Yep.
Not even a hero power. Doesn't want to give a target for Armorsmith or Acolyte Pain.
So we'll see the Acolyte of Pain onto the board, and Doomsayer and, in future turns, the True Silver Champion are great answers to that Acolyte.
This Doomsayer is going to be pretty juicy, right?
I think it's really good right now, yeah.
Yeah, denying any draw from the first Acolyte of Pain.
You know, you could make an argument, I guess, for the Murloc War Leader since it trades, you know, straight up with it, but I think just preventing the entire next turn from Reynad more or less is pretty good. I mean, there's always a possibility on Matten's side that you don't know if there's an Execute coming out of the Warrior, but it's worth the risk.
And I consider cycling the Acolyte of Pain. Execute would give him an answer to the Doomsayer.
Well,
one damage short of being able to clear it.
Might as well just play that weapon.
He's even going to hit a swing?
He's thinking about it.
I like this because, all right. I think in that situation you probably should swing, because if you draw the Deathbite next turn, you're probably going to want to play that, and then you don't get anything out of the Fiery War Axe.
That looks like a Grommash Hellscream.
Whoa. Grommash has really hit rock bottom there, hasn't he?
A bit of stubble. He's really, you know, let himself go. Solemn Vigil online because of the Doomsayer at 3 mana, so able to play that. And it's also worth knowing that there's no ambiguity about Reynad's list. Matten knows there's a lot of reach. He knows it's an aggressive patron list, so getting that early damage in and threatening, whether it's the Leroy or the Grommash or the Ragnaros, early lethal is basically the playtime for Reynad, because the moment that things like Lay on Hands and all the other healing from Matten deck comes through, it's going to be difficult for Reynad to finish off the Murloc Paladin.
Yeah. Well, nice play by Matten. Just gets the True Silver Champion out, handles the Frothing Berserker. Things are going well.
A
Isn't it better to play the Acolyte Pain over the Frothing Berserker?
Well, of course. You don't want to lose the Frothing Berserker again just like that. I mean,
it does kind of suck that you're only getting one draw off of it.
Yeah. Not Hero Parting again. He wants to set himself up for as much of a Battle Rage as he can a little bit later.
Yeah, he doesn't even have Battle Rage at hand just yet.
Not yet. So he knows it's coming.
How do you approach this turn? Because you could use your Weapon Charge, but remember, could just use the Murloc War Leader and Bluegill to trade with the Acolyte. Still denies
really
the draw.
I really like that play because the Bluegill Warrior is still going to survive with 1 HP after making the trade.
Would also finally develop a board.
Yeah, be something.
He could also play double Acolyte.
I guess, but I like this. I like being able to put some pressure onto your opponent that way. Might even decide to save the Weapon Charge. Yeah. Aha, Korokrani Elite, number one. There's a Grim Patron, so starting to maybe sort of move towards that combo, but Raynaud's had some really kind of unfortunate draws this game. He's gotten a lot of his expensive stuff early on. Look at that. I mean, Dr. Boom, Grommash, Ragnaros.
Yeah, and that on the screen just said, what is it? Everyone get in here, the Patron lines.
The infamous call that kind of changed after the Warsong change.
Well, everyone still gets in here now. They just don't pile on.
Yeah, they don't do direct damage either. Wow, he's going to go for it.
Okay.
So there's only so many answers in this deck. There's quite a few, and it seems like he just wants to leverage the minimum amount of tools to potentially draw out specifically an equality, because that would be really massive for Raynaud in terms of future turns.
Well, he's got so many more threats than these Grim Patrons in this deck that he can do this and set up for a better Dr. Boom turn next turn.
Yeah, Mutsun can hold on to his equality this way, too.
Yeah.
So we'll see how Mutsun approaches this turn. He was thinking about playing Acolyte, which would mean he wouldn't be investing into the equality.
You could go Acolyte and Consecrate after you kill the 3-3 with your 2 Silver Champion, and that would clear the board, leave your Acolyte of Pain out there. I guess it'd still get destroyed by the weapon, but you've got two, so...
Equality is just so much more valuable. He's gonna... Now, he has Equality Consecrate in hand, that's why he can afford to take what looks like a very suspicious line from Raynaud.
Well, the other thing, too, is that now he's saying to Raynaud, like, alright, you know, you have to use your dudes to kill my Acolytes of Pain before you use any Whirlwind effects, I suppose, but it is a little bit awkward.
Yeah, but Raynaud is playing really smart, and he's not committing to the board at all.
Well, literally, this is a turn that hasn't been made for many, many a tournament. You know exactly how the patron interactions work at this point, so it's heavily suggesting, at minimum, equality in the hand for Mutsun.
Should be Equality Consecrate this turn. Oh, it could be Equality along with the Wild Pyromancer too, I suppose.
I don't know if I actually agree with what Mutsun has just did. He could have just get away with using one Consecration and keep the Equality for the Pyromancer Equality combo later on in the game.
That's what I was expecting. I thought he was going to hit the 3-3 with his weapon and then just Consecrate.
Me too.
And the reason why that's more flexible is that Equality is relevant at all stages, whereas Consecrate is that more situational card. The Light Lord will push him up.
That music, though. That's so cool.
The Live Insect is also amazing.
He does say Live Insect when he heals too, I believe.
And he does return Die Insect when he attacks, so it's great. So Leroy here would only be 7 damage with this one attack Grommash Hellscream.
He doesn't have any way to deal with the Light Lord right
here. He does have 35 health, so that's...
Yeah, I suppose. But you're running out of removal here if you're the patron.
Yeah, and their Ragnaros is dealing 8 heal every turn.
And 8 damage to you.
So 37, no weapon, we're talking about 32 damage. He will not die to anything.
All right, 8 health, and does he get the Forbidden Healing?
Second Murloc War Leader. Which will be the third, given that one will be the two will be rezzed by the second anything. Needs that War Leader to die, then he would have guaranteed lethal, I believe. It would be 8 damage times 4, which is 32. Which for now isn't lethal, but he's getting closer and closer.
Can Ragnaros the Light Lord heal himself or not?
Yes, he can.
He does? Okay.
It heals
a random, really scary.
Heals a random character.
I thought he couldn't heal himself, but now that he can actually do that to himself.
Yeah, certainly not a clear turn now.
Yeah.
Really wants to hold on to that anything. Must be very close to the bottom of this deck, but crucially has not drawn Old Murkai yet.
Yeah, I think if Madsen clears here and plays Stable Duel.
Has to play a taunt.
Yeah.
He's going to play the Doomsayer as well, it looks like.
Whoa.
Wow. Wow.
Thinking about
really?
It heavily.
So he's thinking of suiciding his own Light Lord?
I don't think I'd do that.
He's heavily debating that Rope is going to burn. Looks like he thinks better of it.
He
Ragnaros
does
the face.
Did he not attack? Oh, no, he did attack earlier. He killed the 3-3. Never mind.
There's some more charge. Leeroy, the only charge minion left in the deck of Reyna, the only finisher. I believe there is an inner rage as well to maybe increase the reach.
Did Reyna use any of his executes yet?
I don't think so.
One inner rage, no execute, I believe.
Okay. No execute in the deck?
No execute used.
Oh, no execute used, okay.
Would have to heavily expect two executes.
So with the unstable goal, the Light Lord is less likely to kill Metsu's face anymore. Oh, he can actually kill the Light Lord, okay.
Yep, and then do a little bit of damage to face with the Korkran Elite.
38 now is still just clear of anything, and we will have an issue where there could be a certain role, and whether Old Murkai came out of the anything could be very relevant.
Whoa.
Let's do the maths here. 38 is what's required. 8, 16, 24, 32. I was correct. That feels good. Sometimes Murloc math is hard, but no cards in hand is going to be very difficult to clear, so...
Yeah, that's the problem, is that he needs to draw like a brawl, and that is not in this deck, I'm pretty sure.
No one card will deal 11 damage.
That's not going to be enough.
One taunt will not be enough. There's the concede, and Madsen. Good problem solving. Realized his situation. No cards in the hand of Reyna Admin. No real chance for that board to be removed, and Madsen is one game away from the grand final. 2-0 up against Reyna.
Man, I gotta say, this Murloc Paladin deck is terrifying and wild. You've got so much healing, so much removal.
And we've never actually seen one of these Murloc Paladins play the Forbidden Healing, which is extra healing on the top of Ragnaros and all the other effects.
Yeah, we saw some yesterday, but it is just... I mean, when you have... And I like Ragnaros Light Lord in this deck, too.
Yeah, me too. It's especially good against Freeze Mage, it seemed like.
Going straight into the potential final game. 3 match points for Madsen. This is going to be a good matchup for him, though, but it isn't Control Warrior. It is going to be Patron Warrior against what you can clearly see is Reno Freeze Mage.
Reno Freeze Mage. Yeah, that's interesting.
So when we have seen these Reno Freeze Mages in Hearthstone Masters, they have included duplicates, so
yep.
Reno will be a lot more situational. That's something that came to punish Kranish yesterday, who had a Reno Secret Paladin but never drew in to Mysterious Challenger to cut down on those duplicates.
Right, and the idea here is similar, where in a Reno Secret Paladin, you're counting on drawing Mysterious Challenger to pull those secrets out and activate Reno. And in this deck, you're kind of looking at using Mad Scientist to pull some of those secrets out of your deck, and then you've just got a couple duplicates for board clear, and you're kind of planning on just having such a long game that you'll save that Reno till the very end. Cold Light Oracle, wow. I had that in my Freeze Mage deck back in 2013.
It's a card that when you have less ability to run duplicates, still run some, but you have to draw the line somewhere. The guaranteed two-card draw of the Cold Light Oracle becomes something situationally that you can consider.
Yeah. I mean, again, when you're running duplicates in a Reno deck, too, you do want to include a lot of draws so you can cycle very quickly through your cards and get rid of those duplicates. Reynard's got a pretty good start here as far as the draws he's going to be able to get out of his Acolyte of Pain, probably. Although the Torch might come in handy. Madsen might just decide to take out the Acolyte that way. Seems pretty good.
Upgrades his reach in the late game as well when the Roaring Torch comes through. So, clean kill on Acolyte and slowing down the drawing for Reynard is looking very attractive. The other option would have been Ice Barrier, which would allow at least two draws for the Acolyte.
All right. So that's the turn for Madsen. Does he attack into this? Okay, he will.
Was this necessary?
I don't think so.
Let's put it in ping territory, but I follow you guys' logic. Seems kind of neither here nor there in terms of decision making.
Yeah, it's plenty of draw. I don't think he really needed to do that.
Maybe he was worried about Frothing Berserker and Whirlwind, but that is one Whirlwind down. I don't know if he should have been afraid about that.
Now you have this four mana turn where me certainly on the uninteresting side. We'll play the Novice Engineer to continue the cycle.
Greynaut's feeling more confident at the moment.
Smork, smork.
You could.
Something going better than expected. Yeah, it does have access to the second Corcoran Elite.
There's no much point in playing the Ravaging Goal because that is going to put your own Corcoran Elite into the hero power range for the mage.
Does have a turn 6 patron combo with Inner Rage and Whirlwind.
You do want to hero power as many times as possible, so that's probably what he's thinking about.
I mean, I think you can make an argument for Ravaging Ghoul and Armor Smith. Gain 3 armor, and yeah, you do put yourself within hero power range, but if they hero power, then that means they have a 3-mana turn. So you do kind of slow down the mage there, too.
I was considering playing Grim Patron, but without the ability to use Whirlwind, seems...
Yeah, you can wait just one more turn and do the Grim Patron, Inner Rage, and Whirlwind.
I mean, if you do that, though, then you're running right into the Blizzard turn, which is... awkward, you know.
But Matsu can still coin out the Blizzard next turn.
Yeah, I suppose that's true.
And he has Flamestrike in this list. Most of the Torch Freeze Mage standard lists we've seen have been cutting that Flamestrike, but it is available.
Smork
was what the first call was, and Smork is what we see.
I mean, if you think about when we saw things like Murloc Paladin beating Freeze Mage yesterday, it's because they were able to get this chip damage in early. So it's kind of the same philosophy with the Patron Warrior right now.
And Reynard has some crazy damage burst. 8, for example, with Inner Rage Leroy, which would have been online on this turn. Doesn't have Leroy in hand, but the potential's certainly there in terms of finishes. And if he can start drawing some premium removal for what is just 2 Corcoran Elites who have already dealt damage, he'll feel pretty good about his position. Reminder to anyone coming in late, Madsen up 2-0. Single elimination, second semi-final, so... the winner of this series goes on to play Strife Crow in the grand final right after this.
So you could coin out a Blizzard here, which is going to kill everything on the board. But if you do that and Reynard uses his Green Patron, Inner Rage, and Warming combo, then you're at a huge risk. So he saw that coming.
Yeah, I like this turn from Metzen. He's playing it slow. He's not getting too worried by these charge minions. He's still got Reno in the hand, and he's not going to be able to use it right away, but...
yeah, and that Acolyte Pain kind of has a taunt by itself, because you want to kill it one shot.
Yeah.
Then we have this interesting scenario where Coin is still available, has Flamestrike, so... although it is a surprising Grim Patron turn with no weapon put together, there is still an answer for patrons in that Flamestrike.
And he's been saving that coin for so long. If you're Reynard, you got to start to be wondering if he's got that Flamestrike in there.
Because this is a Reno list, I think we saw that there is Archmage Antonidas, so coin does have potential other use. But
that's true, too.
Does have a lot of answers still. And
I think this is still the only play for Reynard. I think you still have to go for the Grim Patron turn.
He's really unsure of himself.
It's one of those situations where you're afraid of the removal, but they either have it or they don't. And you really, there's no way to predict it, so just go for it.
What does he do with the Corcoran Elite? Because he hasn't traded yet. We have to keep tabs on that.
He's either going to go face and not Whirlwind, or he's just going to trade and then...
is he going to Whirlwind?
No,
holds on to the Whirlwind. So respect coin into removal. Really interesting heads-up play by Reynard.
Yeah.
Shows restraint in a situation where you could have argued going off when it comes to a patron turn, but...
people always make joke about how Reyna is not a serious player, but when he makes these small little thoughtful plays, it really shows up.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a long-time card game player, of course, in multiple different games. Some of the most famous plays in the infancy of the esports scene were Reynard making creative plays. I remember a famous Hunter play with Savannah Hymane, I think
I remember that, with the 5-mana...
it was
Reno? Rhino?
With the Stampeding Kodo, I believe. No, not Stampeding Kodo, the Tundra Rhino.
The Tundra Rhino, yeah.
That went around the scene a couple of years ago. So one of his rare appearances at a tournament, he's doing... Reynard has the Ragnaros for the turn 8, but for now he's just loading up the board and finally developing some of that armor. It's worth noting that because he's been proactive and charging the face, it isn't the 45-50 effective health total. There's no big armor to speak about for Reynard.
Sludge Belcher from the Freeze Mage.
Hey, you need 30 cards.
I guess. I guess if it's Reno, you can put one in there. Interesting list, though. We can see he does have duplicates of things like Arcane Intellect, too, which kind of surprises me, given that he's got Loot Hoarders, Novice Engineers, and Cold Light Oracles. Do you really need two Arcane Intellect there?
Just feels like the Reno Jackson is sort of an ultra fatigue situation rather than any degree of reliability. Extra draw gets you closer to those duplicates, but so many situational cards does make this list come across as very clunky.
Well, Ragnaros is one of the most difficult cards for the Freeze Mage to deal with. The 8-8 body,
yeah,
and the constant damage.
What do you do this turn? Do you just trade everything in to give only an ooze and the face as targets? Do you just Ragnaros pass the turn?
Guess so.
I think it has to be Ragnaros. The rest of its cards are super situational.
I mean, Ragnaros is pretty safe if you play it here. You've got that unstable ghoul. I suppose it could still die to, fireball ping.
Yeah. Because of the
ghoul.
Well, Ragnaros hitting face will be big.
Oh, 50-50 insect.
So there's no, as far as I know, there is no secret developed right now. I don't believe that Ice Block has been played, but
well,
our Observer overlay makes it hard to tell
for
sure.
Oh, Blood Mage.
Yeah.
Fireball and ping is going to kill the Ragnaros.
That's right.
There is an answer. Waynat sees the, and it's the rightmost card as well. As always seems to be the way in his story.
Well, Raynad's kind of stalled out a little bit, but this Fiery War Axe is actually a nice draw. He's going to be able to get some damage in now.
That reach, Grom Hellscream would certainly be very close to pushing lethal in future turns.
I don't know, man. I don't know. Metzen is holding onto the Ice Barrier.
Have Ice Block developed. Ice Barrier is going to be very crucial, as you mentioned. There's the Ice Block, finally.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
He can stall out the game as long as he wants from this point.
If we start seeing some of these duplicates being played, then, especially the Arcane Intellect, then we might be getting closer and closer to the Reno Jackson becoming online and pushing Matson away from a health total that Reyna can hope to charge down.
Actually, because Matson just uses Blood Mage Thanos, if Reyna can draw into his second green patron, he does